Hello everyone, I hope all of you are doing good. I am Roshni from LearnoHub, the free learning platform where you can learn anything about math, science, English grammar and tips and tricks absolutely for free at learnohub.com. In this video, we are going to learn about the heating effects of electric current, and this is the third video of the video series on electric current and its effects, class 7 science. Have you ever noticed that when a bulb glows for a long time, the area surrounding it becomes hot? Now, why does that happen? Because there is a heating effect associated with electric current, and that is exactly what we are going to study in today's video. So, are you excited about this video? Let's get started. Try to keep your hand, do not touch a glowing bulb, just try to take your hand near a glowing bulb. Do not take it too near as well, because your safety is first. So do not touch the bulb, do not take it very much near to the bulb, but at least take your hand a little near to the bulb. In one case, when the bulb is on. In another case, when the bulb is switched off, take your hand near the bulb. So do you observe any difference in the two cases? So you will see that in case one, the first case, when the bulb is glowing, you feel hot. Whereas in the second case, you do not feel hot. I mean, you do not feel cold as well, but you do not feel hot. So what does it show? The bulb is glowing because current is flowing through it. So current is producing some heating effect, because of which we are feeling the heat. We are feeling hot. Whereas when there is no current flowing through the bulb, there is no heat being emitted and we are not feeling hot. So this is a simple experiment which you can try out yourself, and you can prove that current produces heat. Now the question is, where do we experience heating effects of current? I mean, how is the heating effect of current useful, or where do we use them? So let us look at some examples. The first common example would be the iron. So when you iron your clothes, you make use of it. So what do? You put the plug inside the socket, switch it on, and after some time, what happens? The iron becomes hot. So how is it becoming hot when you are switching it on? Now when you switch it on, a current flows through the circuit inside the iron. Now as current flows through it, there is a certain part of the iron which gets heated. And that heat is then utilized to press clothes. So basically, if you look at the internal structure of the iron box, you will see that there is a frame like this, a frame which is shaped like this inside. This is present inside, and this is made up of nichrome, which is like an alloy, a mixture of nickel and chromium. So nickel and chromium both are metals. So these both metals, they have a very high melting point. I mean, nichrome as a whole has a very high melting point, and it also does not get easily oxidized. So that means it doesn't, react with oxygen very easily. So these are the two advantages with nichrome, and that is why nichrome is used inside iron. So what happens when current passes through this nichrome? So it gets heated up, and this heat is what we feel from outside, and this heat is used to press your clothes. So that is one important advantage of heating effects of current. So iron is not the only example. There are a couple of other examples. For example, the geyser which we use in our bathrooms to heat water. How does a geyser work? So there are materials present inside the geyser which are known as the heating elements, because it is due to those elements that the heating effect of current is experienced. So in this case, this would be termed as the heating element of iron. Had this part not been there, then we would have not experienced the heat of the iron, right? So similarly, even inside the geyser, there is a heating element present, and that heating element heats up, and that heat is then used to make the water hot. The similar concept is used even in case of immersion rods. In fact, something like this is only present as heating element inside the geyser. So these immersion rods can be very clearly seen that they are made up of some metals which when put into water and you plug it and switch it on, after some time it gets heated up and the water also gets heated up. The hair dryer, which is used to dry your hair very quickly, this also has a nichrome wire inside which is wrapped around an insulating mica board. So again, nichrome here is also used because of the advantages of nichrome, of having a high melting point, not easily oxidized. Because of these advantages, it is often used as a heating element in various appliances. So even in hair dryers, if you have ever used a hair dryer, you would have seen that when you plug it and switch it on, you can actually feel a hot air being blown to your hair. And that hot air helps your hair to dry. Another example could be the electric heater, which helps to increase the temperature of the room. It helps to heat the room during winter season. So here also again, you can actually see the presence of the heating element, which are some metals which can be easily seen. So when the metals get heated up, they actually transfer that heat to the room, and that's how it acts as a room heater. So these are some of the applications where we can see how heating effects of current can be utilized. So now that we looked at so many applications of heating effect of current, how do we define heating effect of current? It is the production of heat when electric current passes through a material. In fact, that is what is happening. So when electric current passes through the filament of the bulb, due to this current, heat is produced, which we feel when we keep our hand near the bulb. It is not necessary that all materials will show heating effect. So this effect is actually seen due to the presence of the heating element. So in this case, the filament of the bulb, it acts as the heating element, and the presence of heating element is a must. So heating element can be defined as a coil of wire that has a very high melting point and it do not get oxidized when heated. So that's how we define heating element. So whichever material has this heating element, only that material will show heating effect of current. So appliances containing such elements, when they are connected to an electric supply and then switched on, it gets heated up. So how much heat will be produced by the current? Now, the various factors which determine the amount of heat are material of the wire, length of the wire, thickness of the wire. So these are the three important factors. So when I say material of the wire, what do we mean? So let us look at the Joule's law of heating, a law which was given by the famous scientist Joule. He said that the heat produced by current is proportional to the square of the current, resistance of the wire, and the time for which the current flows through the wire. So this is known as, this relationship is known as the Joule's law of heating. So let us try to understand this relation in more detail. What is I? I is nothing but the current flowing through the wire. So if more current is flowing through the wire, more heat will be produced. What is R? R is resistance of the wire, that is of the conductor through which current is flowing. And what is T? It is the time for which current flows through the wire. Time of current flow, right? Now we try to see how these are the factors which are involved in this relation. So when we say resistance of the wire, how do we determine the resistance of the wire? So resistance of a wire is directly proportional to the length of the wire, and it is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area of the wire. So that is how it is dependent on length of the wire and thickness. What do we mean by thickness of a wire? So this is how a wire looks like, right? It is like a very thin cylinder. So basically this area is known as the cross-sectional area, and this is known as the length. So you see, resistance is dependent on both length as well as cross-sectional area. So we can say that heat is dependent on length of the wire and thickness of the wire. And why on material of the wire? Because here resistance also depends on the resistivity of the wire. and resistivity for different wires are different. So it depends the wire that on what material the wire is made up of. So in case in this case I am referring to wire so many times, wire is can be referred to the heating element of any appliance. So that heating element could be a wire, that heating element could be something else as well. But the how much heat will be produced by a specific amount of current is determined by the properties of the heating element. So now let us look at some important applications of heating effects of current. So one such important and useful application is fuse. What is a fuse? Have you ever heard of fuse? So you would have seen that often people say that sometimes when there is a power cut, they say that, you know, the fuse went off and that is why the power is gone. So what is that fuse? So fuse basically is an element which prevents excessive flow of current through a circuit, because if too much current flows through a circuit, that can destroy the circuit. So it is necessary to put a limitation to the amount of current that can flow through that circuit, because excess current can also spoil the other elements of the circuit. Right, so this fuse is always connected in series with the device so that it can protect the device from unwanted extra amount of current. For example, think of your refrigerator. If too much of current starts flowing through your refrigerator will, I mean, sometimes it will get destroyed, it will get spoiled. So we have to prevent that excess flow of current through the circuit of your refrigerator. So for that we use a fuse which is connected in series with the circuit of the refrigerator. Now different fuses have different ratings, like they can be 1 ampere, 2 ampere, 3 ampere, 5 ampere. So that depends on where they are being used. So here you can see the picture of a fuse. Now how fuse works on the principle of heating effect of current. Now how it prevents excessive flow of current, that is more important to know. Now what happens is, this fuse is made up of a wire which has considerably a lower melting point, so that when huge amount of current passes, now as the amount of current increases, what will happen? As current would increase, the amount of heat produced will also increase as per Joule's law of heating. Now since the metal of which the fuse is made up of, that has a considerably low melting point, so as soon as the heat reaches a certain value, it will melt. So that means as soon as that wire melts, what happens? The circuit is broken. Now as soon as the circuit is broken, there is no flow of current. So it prevents any further flow of current. So now when a switch is rated 1 ampere, it allows up to 1 ampere of current to flow through it. Whenever the current is more than that, it breaks due to overheating, and that's how it prevents further flow of current through the circuit. Now another important application, in fact these days MCBs are substitute to switches, they are preferred over switches. So what are MCBs? You would have seen these kind of structures in your home also. So MCBs are miniature circuit breakers. Why are they called circuit breakers? Because even they help to break the circuit in case of excess current. So whenever there is excess current flow in low voltage circuits, they will help to prevent the flow of current. So what happens with these circuit breakers is that when overload condition or when excess of current flows or other faulty condition happens in the circuit, it automatically switches off the electrical circuit. So entire circuit gets switched off. Now how is it different from fuse is that in fuse you have a wire and the wire melts and breaks. But in this case nothing like that happens. As soon as the current gets overloaded, it gets heated above us beyond a certain limit, then the entire circuit is switched off. So it is only about switching on and off, so there is no breaking of wires or anything. So that means it is more reliable than fuse in sensing the amount of current flow. It can sense it in a better way. So fuse might fail at certain situations, but MCBs never fail. So that is why it is more commonly used than fuse. One advantage is that here we have auto turn off during faulty condition. So in case you have ever observed this in your houses, so this switch which you see, it goes up and then again you can pull it down. So that's how it can be switched on and off. So that means it is very simple to handle. But in case of fuse, once the fuse wire is broken, you cannot repair it yourself. You would need to call an electrician and then he has to handle it with care. So it is a complex process. So this is easy to restore, safe to handle. So restoring it is like, let's say it is switched off. So how do you switch on? Just pull it down. That's all you have to do. Safe to handle because you are not handling with, there is no direct contact with wires, etc. So there are no chances of electric shock. So that means it is safer. Easy to identify the faulty zone. Now when the MCB trips under faulty condition, it trips only at a particular position, which helps to identify the faulty zone easily. Now MCBs are arranged like this. So in whichever zone there is a problem, only that zone would trip. The others would remain still fine. So that means it can be easily determined where the fault is. So that means there are a couple of advantages associated with MCBs which make them more popular than fuse.
I hope you found the video useful. If you have a feedback to share, do let us know in the comment section. If you really like the video, what are you supposed to do? You are definitely supposed to like as well as share the video. I will meet you all very soon with a new video with a new topic. Till then, take care. Bye-bye.